2時からです。昔の欲求不満が溜まってたね。昔あまり弾けなかった。昔思う存分弾けなかったのが、こう40歳になってくるんです。40過ぎて。ダメですね。また負けてますかね。また音楽も負けてますかね。この24時間やってるから、引きずり込まれるんでしょうかね。24時間に負けてるんですか。働いてないから負けてるんですか。まあいろいろありますけど、ディストーション
changes of thousands, hundreds pathways that those genes encode, and there's a lot of redundancy in the human genome. Really, these homologous sequences, these epigenetic modifications, really layer upon layer of regulatory control on top of the DNA sequence itself. The other lesson with cancer is you also get this boom of massive aneuploidy or copy number or mutational changes at once, but rather cancer is actually thought to sort of accumulate mutations over time, and really it's not until the acquisition of a driver mutation where really you start, where things really start to take off, where you start to get this highly unstable genome, highly unstable cell, that then is prone to acquiring additional mutations, such as copy number alterations, and some of that's actually being driven by a therapy itself. And really this model actually is a way to extract, really is number of mutations accumulate over time until you acquire what have now been termed drivers. And really, one of the central challenges in cancer genome research is to differentiate a driver mutation from the inevitable passenger mutation set. Accumulate over time, but are not thought to have biological function. I mentioned external forces, like drug treatment can select for specific clones. I just have a slide later on about this idea of clonal selection within a complex cell population. But before I got there, I want to talk a little bit about mutation burden, this idea of the number of mutations in each cell. And really, in this analysis here from the Broad Institute, just looking at the number of mutations across all cancer types, and the general trend being that pediatric cancers and hematological malignancies being relatively low mutation rate, the cancers associated with environmental exposure, smoking, sun exposure, have a higher mutation rate. I'm not so sure about hamburgers, but in general, higher mutation rates on the right-hand side of the slide. But really, it's not a hard and fast rule. At the population level, yes, these cancer types have low mutation rates, but I've sort of highlighted two sort of anecdotal exceptions to the rule. Neuroblastomas is actually the work I did while I was a postdoc there, this sort of mysterious case with an amazing number of mutations, actually just as many mutations as a late-stage lung cancer. This was actually a child with neuroblastoma. In this case, they were the only patient with two hits in the DNA repair gene. They had a mutation of one copy of MLH1 and a deletion of the other copy. This cancer cell had lost its ability to repair its DNA. So in this case, we had a nice molecular reason for what would be expected to be a low mutation rate cancer to have a very, very high mutation rate. The exact opposite story here in melanoma. This is actually the only melanoma in that study that did not have sun exposure. It's actually a tumor on the bottom of a patient's foot. Just extraordinarily bad luck. They had cancer of the same cell of origin as other traditional melanomas. But again, very different at the molecular level. Even though down the microscope, the cells looked like melanoma. It was really different at a fundamental level. This very famous slide has been updated actually several times. Really, this idea of hallmarks of cancer, really the idea to take these biological themes or biological processes that are active in cancer and assign them into relatively few distinct characteristics. So this circle has actually grown quite a bit since the original Hanahan-Weinberg hallmarks of cancer paper, but really this idea of tumor cells acquiring abnormal activities using pathways that are already active in normal cells. Really this idea of cancer being dysregulation of normal cell processes and often turning on pathways in a cell that they otherwise should not be active in, driving, sustained proliferative signaling, evading growth suppressors, et cetera, et cetera. Really this idea of just reusing pathways that already exist. This idea that oncogenic somatic mutations target a core set of biological functions. And you'll hear me use a couple of terms, this idea of driver mutations or oncogenes. These are really thought to be sort of the activating mutations, really the mutations, copy number alterations, rearrangements that drive or activate pathways that shouldn't be expressed. And the other category being tumor suppressor genes. These are sort of the cells of brains. These are trying to be turning off pathways, and these are the genes that are commonly deleted or have lost mutations. And the whole point of that gene sequencing is you'll read out all of these patterns of cancer cell variation and then resolve. These tumors are they all the tumor genome, the cancer genome atlas at the time, picked out relatively few genes that have been linked to pathways. And what they found is that you really don't want to look at these genes in a single way. I'm talking about genes that are actually being hit, not just by one mutation, not just by one mutation. Really, this idea of genes being hit in multiple different ways, using multiple different types of cancer genome variation, but having the same activation or tumor suppressor or cancer driver. The other big lesson from this study, so the very great reason, each colony is a cancer type, each row is a gene, and the journal of the pathway diagram now reaches sort of different fields, needs. So the lessons from the study is, number one, when drug alterations across cancer types in the space of geomarker information happens in bladder and two other cancers as well, so this idea of one drug, one cancer type, really starting to fall away as you get this high expression of the cancer genome. Combination therapies may be effective, but with the viral infection is cancer associated with that viral infection. How is that cancer different from other cancers of this type? And not only what it does, it targets the one infection. So the next part of the talk probably a little more technical things, a little closer to bioinformatics theme. How do you find next generation data sequencing to cancer specifically? So I grossly simplified this, but this is really how the four critical steps for genomics in general happen. You extract genomic DNA and RNA from a cell, biopsy, blood, cell-free DNA, some sort of extraction. You make a library. A library is essentially DNA that's been made compatible with a machine that can read DNA. So basically you take this DNA, in the case of Illumina sequencing, which I'm almost going to be showing exclusively, you put little examples on either end that are unique to that machine. You then load that DNA onto a machine-like Illumina sequencing device that generates a huge text file of A, C's, T's, and G's. And this is really where things are much less standardized, or more and more people get less standardized.
Viewer. I think there's a little tutorial session.
case, we're only looking at 92 base pairs at a time. In white, you would need a reference sequence, and in gray, you have a histogram of the number of grays and lines in each base. These are all the grays and the data I showed on the slide earlier, and if you already see that data represented in this way,
interested in if you're questioning this specifically around coding sequence. And RNA sequencing, you let the cell do
exons are attached to which exons, and this is also quantitative, so if you have very, very high coverage of specific genes, those genes are expressed at a higher level, and the genes that have low coverage are expressed at a low level. I use the phrase whole exome and whole genome sequencing, but it's really a bit of a misnomer. They really don't actually measure anything, or probably more specifically, we don't have great bioinformatic methods to assign absolutely every single sequencing read uniquely to a portion, to a region of the human genome. This is actually a slide from my own work with neuroblastoma. In this case, each little tiny, tiny splice here is a neuroblastoma tumor. And the y-axis here is a single exon. So each little splice going this way is an exon. One means that we are completely confident in where those reads were aligned and our ability to find mutations in those exons. And so these are sort of the regions where we had no doubt we can find mutations and we're good covered and we're well powered. As you go to the bottom of this plot, you can see our confidence in calling mutations essentially drops to zero, not just in the exome sequences, which are purple, but also in the whole genome sequences. Well, it's a really sort of blind spot in the genome where just the highly repetitive, our reads are short, we just cannot be confident in our read and in our ability to find mutations necessarily in this region. The other interesting technical aspect is that the blind spots in the genome are often, well, down here they're essentially the same as exome sequencing, but often they're actually not the same as exome sequencing due to differences in read length. With exome sequencing, since you are able to focus the vast of your DNA sequencer on a relatively smaller genomic footprint, you can have sequence those regions to much deeper coverage and might have much greater confidence in the mutation calls at each of those places. So I still use the terms whole genome and whole exome sequencing because the concept is you are really trying to be as comprehensive as possible, but it does not necessarily mean 100% of the genome or exome consists. So I think at the time it was about 80% of the whole exome was covered at, say it was only 14 exomes needed to be covered. I think that number has probably gone up to 19 plus now. But I think there's still a lot of room for a lot of sort of custom panels to look, especially at these hard to read regions.
Transcript, and you can see the trial corresponding transcripts here in the ER negative breast cancer are really
は買って昔は
買ったなって言われ
て AIB を買ったなって言われて
The third type of Cancer genome variation is being used more and more in sequencing is epigenetic modification. In this case, it's another IGV screenshot. I've shown the MLH line here on the bottom. Here's the promoter that controls this gene. And in this region, methylation of this promoter expression of that gene. So in this case, here's a normal tissue. This promoter is unmethylated, which actually results in normal expression of that tissue. Here's the exact same data, the exact same acid run.
ドラミコはギターとボーカルとフレーズの合わせが好きです。
最近見てばかりです。
バンデマになるといいね。まあ別にバンドにならなくてギターの編集とかやってもいい。
But there is an additional challenge of just